In 2011, a long-running scam was discovered. A social psychologist named Dietrich Stoppel had essentially been making up data for all his studies. At least 30 published peer-reviewed papers were based on fraudulent data. One paper said that meat eaters behaved more selfishly than vegetarians, and another said that a messy environment could make people more racist. At first, people noticed a few figures that seemed to be identical between studies, which he brushed off as a misprint that he'd avoid in the future. But soon people noticed that the data were just too good to be true. Effect sizes were huge, the standard deviations were small, and the papers were really vague about how the data was collected. But it turned out he was doing all the collection himself, and his graduate students and collaborators all thought he was doing them a favor. But it was all a sham. In the past few weeks, another peer-reviewed paper was discredited, but with an entirely different story. In 2010, a study was published on the benefits of power poses. Supposedly, standing like a confident superhero could alter your neurochemistry, lowering your cortisol, raising your testosterone, and improving your performance.
There was even a TED Talk.
But one of the authors of that study recently wrote, "I do not believe that power pose effects are real," citing numerous failed attempts to repeat the study, along with some flaws in the original that she said were more clear in hindsight. In the case of this study on power poses, along with all of Stoppel's retracted research, these were studies that passed peer review. Independent scientists, usually anonymous, looked through the research and said it was okay to publish. So how'd they get through? And can we prevent them from getting through? Before we can address the holes in the floodgate of science, you might wonder why the flood pressure is so high to begin with. Look at most any scientific paper and you're likely to see, near the end, something like, "The authors report no conflict of interest regarding this manuscript," which should probably be amended with, "Aside from the fact that we had to keep publishing something pretty regularly in order to keep our jobs, and the journals are most interested in publishing new and exciting things." Because of that, they might be on the lookout for the few significant effects in a much larger set of data, and then decide to publish only that, leaving out the fact that those few effects were fished from a much larger data set. This is a form of p-hacking, reporting only the significant relationships when a more complete picture of the data would suggest that it's just a fluke. The pressure to publish can lead scientists to cherry-pick the findings that are significant, and also in line with their hypotheses. 96% of published studies report positive results for their hypotheses. Despite the fact that good science requires reporting of results that reject hypotheses, as well as those that confirm them, scientists are often just ignoring or forgetting about studies that didn't work, because they think they won't be publishable.
Either that or they tweak their studies to make them publishable.
You might also recall a study we talked about previously on this channel, in which published academic papers were resubmitted to the same journal, and then 89% were rejected, occasionally citing serious methodological flaws. So is there anything we can do to improve the gatekeeping? Make the peer review process stronger so fewer of these flimsy studies get through? One possible solution is to make sure all reviews are double blind. Most journals employ at least single blind reviews in which the reviewers are anonymous, but double blind reviews in which the reviewers don't know who submitted the paper are more rare, and occasionally they're optional. This can increase inequality in professional science. Famous psychologists can get a bit of a pass if they run a shoddy study, whereas people just starting out in their careers get closer scrutiny. Double-blind peer review makes it easier for reviewers to be critical of prestigious scientists, rather than starstruck. Some argue that requiring researchers to report some additional statistics will help reviewers and readers identify some flaws and limitations to the study that just reporting p-values don't. But in some cases, these numbers are all effectively mathematically equivalent, like making sure to report temperature in both Celsius and Fahrenheit. Some readers will be familiar with one over the other, and there might be some inferences or conclusions suggested by using one or the other, but it's not going to present any more definitive criteria for truth. But this can only help, it can't hurt. A promising idea is to split the review process into two steps. Right now, people submit their research for publication after all the work is done, hypotheses made, data collected and analyzed, and conclusions reached. Two-step review could require researchers to submit just their hypothesis and research methods before doing the actual research. And then the decision to publish would just be based on whether the research question was interesting and their methods were sound. Then after running the study, there's a second review to be sure they did what they said. but the journal will still publish it, even if the hypothesis was rejected. The hope is that this would remove any incentive to manipulate data before publication, or ignore any negative effects. And scientists would still get published despite rejected hypotheses. It would still be based on them doing good science. So perhaps the Dietrich Stoppels of science would be less motivated to cheat. But some research like the PowerPost study might still get through. It had some flaws, but it was overall conducted in good faith with no intent to manipulate the data. For example, something they did just to be frugal and save money, they stopped running subjects after they found the effect, was actually functionally equivalent to p-hacking, even though they didn't mean to. But this is why replications are critical, especially in social sciences. It was after the failed replications of the PowerPost study that the flaws of the original became clear. And in this case, the appropriate thing to do was exactly what happened. Admit the flaws, concede it was a false positive, and draw attention to the failed replications. It's okay. This is how science works. Thanks for watching, and I'll see you next time.